Number one, hello Global Baba and Mr. Michael Bush. Please, sir, help explain 1 Corinthians 11, 12 to 13. I need clarity. Thank you very much. 1 Corinthians 11, 2 to 13.
Ah, that's a long
one. A long one.
1 Corinthians.
We'll just look at what it says. Yeah, can you get us this
put
one?
Put it up from verse 2. And now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the ordinances as I delivered them to you. Next verse. But I will have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is a man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head. You must always pay attention to what you read. Don't just read your religion into the Bible. He says the head of Christ is God. The head of the man is Christ. The head of the woman is the man. So every woman praying, having her husband exposed, disgraced, insulted, embarrassed, is a shame to her. What is simply establishing is submission to the leadership of a husband in the home. At the church in Corinth, that a woman is not supposed to expose and disgrace her husband and then come to church and be praying like a saint. A woman has a responsibility to cover her head, which is the husband. And the husband has the responsibility not to cover his head, which is Christ. He should open Christ. Let people see Christ in his life. Let people see Christ by the way he preaches and teaches. That's what Paul was discussing there. Not scarf, not head tie, not beret. He was discussing leadership and submission in the home.
Okay. Blue Baba.
The Intercontinental.
You know, the pastor that said, you talk as if you wrote the Bible, is right. I am with him. Because, I mean, Blue Baba, how is it that? Ah, no. Okay, anonymous number 2, Global Baba.
I'm here.
God bless you, Dr. Abel Damina, for the marvelous revelation you have given me through your teachings on Christ. I'm persuaded that I'm now born again, but I have a few questions to ask you about the nature of God. In one of your teachings, knowing God beyond superstition, you mentioned that God does not kill, which I believe, but what about Luke 19:27? The indignant king ended by saying, but as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them in my presence.
Yeah, it is a parable Jesus was giving about people who rejected him. So if you reject the gospel, the lesson in that parable is that if you reject Christ, you'll be sent to eternal damnation. That is what that parable there was saying. Don't take it literal. Just get the lesson out of the parable.
Anonymous number 3, greetings Global Baba and Intercontinental Mr. Bush. I've been following your teachings of recent on Facebook. Please, sir, can you graciously give me a concise interpretation and application of first fruit of one's earning?
Now, there's no first fruit of one's earning in the Bible. So if anybody's teaching you that he's just trying to eat your money, that's all. Using religion to eat your money, that's all. There's nothing like first fruit as money. First fruit in the Bible is a language of communicating that Christ is our first fruit. So Christ is the first fruit of all those who died. That is when Jesus rose, he rose with a bunch. That resurrection was first fruit. And if the people that get born again, like in a church, if somebody gets born again, he's part of the first fruit in that church. So first fruit has nothing to do with money.
Money.
It is a mode of communicating the resurrection of Christ, how that Christ is the first to be risen from the dead, along with those who slept in Christ in the Old Testament. So don't give anybody your money in the name of first fruit. However, if you believe in a ministry and you're blessed by that ministry, of course, you bless them,
support
you
them.
Give to support, but not as a first fruit, but as a responsible child of God.